I'm Richard Heffner, your host on The Open Mind for the last half century and more. And this Open Mind special, consisting of two programs first recorded and broadcast in the mid-1980s, is presented now in memory of and as a tribute to Norman Mailer, truly an American icon.
I'm Richard Heffner, your host on The Open Mind. Years ago, when a television station was actually paying me to do this program each week, I wondered how someone could possibly be so lucky as to be rewarded for doing what he so much enjoyed doing, which is somewhat the thought that occurred to me recently when I wondered about quite how many superlatives that I use in introducing The Open Mind. An extraordinary book, today's brilliant guest, what a fascinating idea, and so on. And I appreciated all over again what a blessing it is to deal so frequently with ideas and individuals one has chosen just because they are quite so extraordinary, brilliant, fascinating. Which is a particularly appropriate formulation right now, because my guest and the themes I would like to probe with him today, and next week too if he'll stay around, range not only so far and wide, but so now and forever as they merit all of the superlatives at my command. First, however, a birthday greeting to Norman Mailer, Aquarian, who yesterday ended January by getting older and presumably even wiser, which of course leads me to ask him just how much wisdom was displayed by the poets, playwrights, editors, essayists, and novelists brought together and perhaps set asunder by the International Pen Congress that he presided over here in America last month. Mr. Mailer?
Indeed.
How wise were they?
I think most of the wisdom took place in the corridors and over drinks and in the conversations. And it reminded me all over again that writers are essentially people who like to have a conversation with one or two people more than they like to address audiences. So I don't know. I mean, we had a huge Congress and an awful lot of great many good things happened, some bad things happened.
What were the unwise things that happened?
Oh, it was a comedy of errors. You know, we had never done anything like it before, and so we, for instance, the day that Secretary Schultz appeared at the opening session of the Congress, which therefore was a large and prestigious affair at the public library, there were a great many people in Penn who resented his presence and proceeded to write about it and sign letters protesting his presence. And then there were people who were calling from the audience and they wanted to produce a letter and present it to him. And a little simple communication back and forth would have helped a lot.
And yet you had said that I knew if someone came in who's ultra-left, there would be no outrage. If someone came in who was right-wing, there would be a protest. Why? What does this tell us about writers?
I think most writers, most serious writers, are generally opposed to the government, that they, the state they live in. I think this is natural. Writers are particularly talented writers, because untalented writers are often highly developed functionaries. They're functionaries of the word and the paragraph, and they can write manipulative prose. There's a great difference in my mind between people who write manipulative prose. Those prose is trying to get people to do certain things in certain ways. Inspirational books would come under the head of manipulative prose. And there are people who are really trying to communicate a vision of life, such as it is. It can be a warped vision of a life, an angry vision, a satiric vision, or whatever, but it's their vision. And when they're trying to do that, they're trying to write as well as they possibly can. And they tend almost always to be critical of the country that they live in.
But not
and thereby serve an immensely valuable purpose. It's like the critical factor, you might say, where would we all be if we didn't have a critical side to our brain that was always monitoring our actions and saying, well, you've made a damn fool of yourself again.
But why would you use the word if you weren't attempting, well, you say manipulate, let's forget about that, if you weren't attempting to move people in your direction?
I think there's two ways to move people in your direction. One is to try to move them humanly. That is, you just speak to them the truth of your own experience. You say, this is what I've learned from these particular experiences. And if you agree with me, maybe you go along with what I feel is true. And there's another way where you study the weaknesses in people and you study their sentimental hot spots, so to speak, and you touch them. And you play them with great skill. And there are any number of powerful politicians and statesmen who are absolute masters at that. We know a few in the world today. We don't even have to name them. We know exactly who they are.
And writers, too, you're saying?
No, writers are bad at that. Good writers are bad at that. Bad writers,
okay.
Manipulative writers, are very good at that. You know, I can give you a title or two, How to Improve Your Heart, in 5 weeks. That's a book that's bound to sell. A lot of people are worried about their heart condition. If they believe that a book can tell them how to improve their heart in 5 weeks, they'll go out and they'll buy it. That's manipulative. Again, to go back to what I said, if people write directly out of their experience, if they're trying to communicate the truth of their experience to someone else and saying, well, maybe you will agree with me, that's not manipulative.
Well, as president of PEN America, you began the meeting in January 86. You said, we are in love with the word, we are proud of it. You said, our works, writers, are, we may hope, exquisitely constructed elucidations of our most private prayers, obscene, atheistic, or devotional, but still our prayers, close to curses. Writers may be the last humans to inflame with words. Let us have an extraordinary week, then, with bonfires of words, explosions of words, votive lights of words, luminescences of words. Let us return to the war and the play of words that will yet show our battered wife of a world some glimpse of starlight in the aesthetic heavens. Did it happen?
Well, before we get into that, there was one word left out in what you read. I think it was inflame themselves with words. The writers are the last to inflame themselves with words.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than inflame with words.
All right.
Since they're my words, it matters to me.
I stand corrected.
Did it happen?
Excuse me, let me stop. You mean not inflame others, but inflame themselves?
First, you inflame, that's the difference. You see, the manipulator inflames others with words. The true writer first inflames himself or herself with language.
The flame isn't there before you put the word on paper?
If you write without a flame, then you're manipulating.
So the flame is there. You're not inflaming yourself. You have a purpose when you sit down.
Well, we can make a great deal of it. But what I was trying to say is that that we intoxicate ourselves with words, and we're the last who do. Most people nowadays intoxicate themselves with music, with sports, with self-improvement, with bodybuilding. We inflame ourselves with words. We're writers.
You know, Neil Postman, who was writing about... who has long since been writing about the impact of the electronic media, seems to believe that given the electronic media of our times, we may become less and less involved with the written word. Does that seem to you to be the case?
Oh, it's a great concern of mine. I think it's quite possibly going to happen. I wouldn't know how to put it, but I just feel that television leeches out interest in the written word. I think that we're all becoming reduced. Serious novelists are becoming almost as rare, almost as much a luxury to culture as poets were just 20 years ago. In other words, there were people 20 years ago who would read novels and wouldn't think that much about reading poetry. They didn't feel any longer they really had to read poetry. Reading a good novel was enough, or even reading a novel was enough. I think at this point, reading a good novel is equal in the average person's mind to reading poetry. Why be bothered with it? It's too difficult. It's too tricky. To what end?
And what's the impact of that observation upon publishers and publishing in this country?
Well, it's getting more and more difficult to get a good, serious first novel printed that doesn't have much chance of selling. It's exactly this. You see this exactly the same phenomenon on Broadway. I look through the list over. I think there's one serious play on Broadway right now, Blood Knot. The others are all, they can be good plays, but they're musicals, they're entertainments, essentially. And I think something of the same is happening in publishing, that a young editor, and generally it's young editors who bring in new novelists, you know, because they're the same age and they tend to pal around together, I think are finding it harder and harder to get a young novelist printed, because the publishing house knows they're going to lose money on that writer, and the economics are such that there's just not room for the small venture any longer that loses money.
Was that demonstrated in any way in the PEN meeting, other perhaps than the difficulty in when you were reproached and approached with the question of women at the PEN meeting? You made some comments, I believe, that had to do with the difficulty in getting sufficiently fine writers who were women, too.
Well, that went through quite a mangle. Actually, the objection of the women, and the women who objected were, may I say, professional objectors. I mean, Betty Friedan is, you know, a professional. I don't mean the word invidiously, but she is a professional agitator. She lives for moments when she can find possibly some wedge where women aren't being treated properly, so she can run in and get a good deal of publicity for herself.
But either the wedge is there or it isn't. Was it
well,
there?
Well, the fact is that the reason it was there in the first place, the reason we had many fewer women than men on the panels is because we never paid attention to it. We never noticed it. And the reason we never noticed it is that Penn has so many women in positions of importance all through the organization that we just don't think that way. We don't have a gender problem. We don't say, how many women do we have on this committee? How many men do we have on this committee? After it was all over, I was curious. I went through our committees. We have eight permanent committees that are important in Penn, that do the various jobs that Penn takes care of, Freedom to Write Committee, membership committees, so forth. And six of the eight chairmen of these committees are women. Now, I've never made a nose count before, because it just hadn't been necessary. There are a great many women in Penn on the executive board and doing the work. I counted our vice presidents. We have six vice presidents, three are women. We just simply didn't pay attention to all this. It wasn't a matter of concern to us. We don't think that way. The idea of having a certain number of women on a panel is absurd to me. If I ever saw a panel where there were eight women and two men, I promise you I wouldn't say, how dare they do this? What are they discriminating about? I would just say it just so happened that there are eight women who know a lot about the subject and two men.
But the sensitivity that...
Well, I think it's an outrageous sensitivity, because I think it's going too far. That is, women had, 20 years ago, women had a great many things to complain about they no longer have to complain about. When you have middle-class people engaged in activities, when their economic base is secured, there's only one question you ask, and that is excellence served? I said in the course of that Congress at one point, when I was chair on the last day, that the only excuse for the middle class is excellence, is the search for excellence. The middle class is a peculiar class. They have neither the fundamental vigor and sense of outrage of the working class, and they don't have the elegance of the upper classes. What they have is a passionate desire to improve themselves, and when they do, they're an honorable class. When the middle class searches for excellence, it's exciting and interesting. When the middle class gets complacent and starts counting the value of its family condominium compared to the next family condominium, or how many women, or how many men, or how many this, or how many that are on a committee, then they're kind of silly.
You know, you said in relation to this, and you were quoted after the Penn meeting as having said, there are countries in the world where there are no good women writers. Then you said, I'm going to have to pay for that for years with lousy reviews.
Let me say that covered, that was the first and the last sentence in a long paragraph. What I said in between is that I said there are countries in the world where there are no good women writers. I said this ought to prove the woman's point, that women are seriously exploited in many places in the world. And one of the marks of that exploitation, precisely, is that you don't have women writers in countries where women are egregiously exploited. Well, that's what I said in the middle, and that got left out.
And at the end, when you indicated, what, that there was a, if not an old boys' network, then at least an old girls' network in reviewing of books, that you'd have to pay a price for those
Well,
comments?
I think what's happened is that the women do have such power in America by now. I mean, I've visited college campuses where there isn't a male on the camp, on the faculty, who dare ever stand up to any of the women, because they will, I don't know why they don't, but they don't. They're really terrified of the women. The women intellectuals on the faculty control the faculty for all practical purposes. I was on a campus once where the first day I got there, somebody wrote a commentary about me, a column about me. I was going to be on the campus for a week lecturing in the college paper. That was the worst piece of gutter journalism I'd seen since Dorothy Kilgallen died. Now that goes back, what, 30 years? So, I mean, you have to go back to Walter Winchell and Dorothy Kilgallen to find stuff that was that bad, that was that gutter press in a reputable college paper. So I said to the editor of the paper, happened to be a man, I said, a boy, I said, well, all right, I would like to write an answer to that. This was really pretty awful. And he hemmed and he hawed and he flim-flammed all over the place, but finally what he came down to was no, they didn't want my answer. And it was one of the few times that I'd given an offer of free writing that it wasn't taken up. Well, he was terrified of the women on the paper. This is absurd. I mean, this is going too far.
What happens then to a society in which that observation is correct?
What observation is correct?
That things are going too far. You talk about a...
Oh, well, I'll give an example of what's happened already. I think the women have ruined the Democratic Party. the Democratic Party has had candidates throughout the last 12 years that are about as rousing as oatmeal. And one of the reasons is that no man can rise in the Democratic Party now who doesn't say women first. The women are wonderful, whatever the women want. In the old days...
We used to say women first, women and children first.
Yes, but what I'm getting at is that when the women, for instance, insisted that Mondale take a woman as a vice presidential candidate, that was silly politics. That was absurd. You don't say take a woman for the candidate. You say who's going to make the best running mate for Mondale so that there's a chance to beat Reagan. Now, they said there's got to be a woman or we're going to revolt, and they would have. They'd have messed the Democratic Party up totally if he hadn't given them a woman. So what they do is they got in a panic. The Democrats got in a panic, and they looked around, and they had two choices. They had Dianne Feinstein in San Francisco, the mayor of San Francisco, and she'd been divorced a couple of times, I gather, so they were nervous about her. And besides, San Francisco is a homosexual city, and they were worried about that. And the other choice was Jerry Ferraro, who has got a marvelous personality. She's lively, she's bright, she's tough, she's a good candidate, she speaks well on the stump, she's terrific. But they didn't go in for the kind of examination you got to give a vice presidential candidate. They didn't learn a thing from Eagleton. And the reason they didn't learn is they were in a hurry and they were in a panic and the women were on their ears and they were on their backs and they were clawing at them and saying, you better have a woman, Mondale, or you're in a lot of trouble. Now, there's one candidate Mondale could have had, and that was Hart. That would have made sense. That would have made sense the same way when Kennedy picked Lyndon Johnson. It would have unified the party. The women would have had all the power in the world. They have enormous power in the Democratic Party already. They would have had power in some other fashion. You don't have to have tokenism. You don't have to have the symbolic candidate. You don't have to have a woman who's a vice president. I mean, there's nothing special about men or women that makes them ideally suited to be candidates. The leading woman politician in the world today is Maggie Thatcher. And she's got politics that would make the average liberal Democrat make their stomach curdle.
But if there's nothing special about women that would make them particularly good candidates...
Or bad candidates.
And I presume you're saying the same thing about men.
Yes, there's nothing special about any given man that makes him... what I'm getting at is there are individuals who make good candidates. And there are combinations of individuals that make a good president and vice president, or a good running team for a campaign.
What are you going to do about the question that's raised so often about compensation, about moving to the development? As you said, your comment about good women writers are not to be found in many countries, which is an indication of let's call it the sexism that exists there and the exploitation of women that exists there. How do you overcome that if you don't find yourself on the short end at times at the beginning of women in politics?
Well, I would say that a lot of the women who are carrying on right now in New York about how many women are on this panel, how many women are on that panel, well, they know in their hearts that they have equality at least, and possibly they've got superiority in New York, because most publishing houses now in New York are run by women. The women are in no trouble in New York. I mean, the idea that women have no rights in New York is absurd. Let them go down to Texas. Let them go down to Alabama. Let them go down to Mississippi and fight for their sisters there. Let them go to these third world countries. Let them start a Peace Corps and go there and work. Let them go out and get shot on the line. Let them die for their ideas. But they're just pushing around a poor little gaggle of male liberals in New York. They can't even take over the Republican Party in America, which is where the male still has centrality and control.
But you say they have taken over the Democratic Party.
Absolutely, which is why the Democratic Party keeps losing elections, because by the time a candidate gets done satisfying the women, there's nothing left of the candidate.
You know, you talk about women and...
I mean, look at the candidates we've had.
In the Democratic
Party.
Yeah.
I mean, they've all been representatives of oatmeal. I mean, the last one with any honor was George McGovern. And he had to start satisfying the women a great deal, maybe too much. Then after that, who'd you have in 76? Jimmy Carter.
The women's candidate?
Absolutely. Carter again in 80.
So where do
then
we go?
Then Mondale.
What's the male at ticket then?
Well, Teddy Kennedy. Somebody real.
Not involved with women?
I don't want to put a curse on it, but Mario Cuomo. That's a good candidate. Gary Hart's suitable. There are a lot of candidates who work, but the question of whether they have a woman for a vice president is something that's decided on its merits. Jerry Ferraro was simply not ready to be a vice president. She was a congressman. The last time anyone picked a congressman to be a vice president was when Barry Goldwater chose Bill Miller. Remember Bill Miller?
Sure,
he chose Bill Miller because Bill Miller was a preventive. Bill Miller was a preventive against getting assassinated. Nobody ever saw Bill Miller was going to shoot Barry Goldwater.
The wonderful thing about Bill Miller is that he said that about himself.
Well, he wasn't a stupid man. He just wasn't a very big man.
You know, I can't help but go back to, let's see, March 71. Norman Mailer really has that issue that month of Harper's Magazine. The Prisoner of Sex is...
That's a perfect example, man. Hold that up. I want to show something.
Sure. Sure. Let's see if we
can... This article, The Prisoner of Sex, where was the camera? Over there? Is
it? It should be over here.
Somewhere.
Sure.
This... You have to read it about five times before you can make it out. It reads like the prisoner of sex.
The impact of a woman editor?
Now, yeah, absolutely. When I saw it, I said, uh-oh, some woman who hated this piece designed that cover. And in fact, I happen to be right.
Tell me about hating the piece, though. Why would a woman hate it?
Because she didn't read it.
Well, I read it, and now I've lost that wonderful point at the end. Here it is. If she had read it, she would have found Mailer saying about himself, so he was grateful to a writer who wrote a book, The Lady, published in 1910, Emily James Putnam, the first dean of Barnard. She was a writer with a whip of the loveliest wit. He would give her the last quotation. He would give the last quotation to her, for she had given the hint of a way. The hint of a way, the hint of a way was sort of an answer to the question that you began your article with, who's going to do the dishes?
Mm-hmm.
Now, is it so surprising that Betty Friedan and a lot of others would have gotten up there at Penn and assumed that Norman Mailer, president of Penn in America at that point, was giving expression to attitudes toward their sex that they found anathema?
Yes, but they didn't explore it. They were just there to get onto the front page of the New York Times, and they succeeded. They're very good at that. The fact of the matter is that Penn is an honorable organization, which has absolutely no problem with men or women. We never think about that. We really, we're reasonably sophisticated people there. We simply haven't thought about that in a long time.
But forgetting...
I'm giving you these statistics. We have six of our eight chairmen are women.
Okay.
Of our permanent committees. There aren't too many organizations that can say that comfortably.
All right, but let me ask...
Did Betty Friedan ask that? No, she just said, why... Or, you know how it all started on the opening day of the ceremonies. She said, Norman, I noticed there aren't too many women on the panels. I said, oh, for God's sakes, Betty, don't play the numbers game. So that was a dumb thing that I did, because I gave Betty the idea. She said, oh, I think I will play the numbers game, and she did. But what she was doing is she was bad-mouthing an honorable organization, Penn. She was doing us a lot of harm. She was making us look silly in the papers. She got our executive secretary up there in tears, apologizing. It was all nonsense. One of the reasons why we had so many men on the committee and so few women is most of the good women that we invited for one reason or another didn't come.
Mr. Mailer, I think it probably correct to say that most Americans reading about Penn in January 86 were much more interested in Mailer, were much more involved with Norman Mailer than they were with your distinguished organization, so that I come back to the question that you raised in The Prisoner of Sex, who's going to do the dishes? Who's going to do the dishes? Not in Penn. Presumably they don't have any dishes, dirty or clean.
I really don't follow you. Who's going to do the dishes in relation to Penn?
No, I'm saying let's drop Penn for the moment. What's happened to Mailer's ideas about
who's going to do the dishes?
Yeah.
Well, it is a terribly tough idea, who does the dishes. And I think it probably comes down to who does the... how do you divide the work in a marriage? And I never was able to answer it in that.
But you did say that...
I can tell you, in my own life, I end up doing the dishes as much as anyone in the family. We got a lot of people in my family.
Well, that's fair enough, but here in 71...
I can answer your question.
Okay.
You have a happy household when there really isn't great attention paid to who does the dishes. That's when you've arrived. When you get to the point where whoever happens to be around and sees there are a lot of dirty dishes does it, then you got a nice household. Now, there are times when I would make that claim for my house, my home, that whoever's there does do the dishes. There are times when the kids will come in and do the dishes, or there are times when I'll do them, or there are times when my wife will do them. I think there's a general feeling that the one who is least tired ought to do the dishes.
And yet, look, you're the one who wrote, and I quoted you, misquoted you in one instance before. You said, we are in love with the word, we are proud of it. The word, you went on, precedes the formation of the state. Well, your words in 71, in The Prisoner of Sex, not hidden by an editor by working over the cover, You quoted Dean Putnam, and you said she had given the hint of a way. She wrote, and you quoted, "Apart from the crude economic question, the things that most women mean when they speak of happiness, that is love and children and the little republic of the home, depend upon the favor of men, and the qualities that win this favor are not in general those that are most useful for other purposes. A girl should not be too intelligent or too good or too highly differentiated in any direction. Like a ready-made garment, she should be designed to fit the average man. She should have, quote, just about as much religion as my William likes, end quote. The age-long operation of this rule, by which the least strongly individualized women are the most likely to have a chance to transmit their qualities, has given it the air of a natural law." You do find that the hint of a way out of the problem.
No, I'm saying you're misreading that woman. Forgive me, but I think you are. She's saying that satirically. She's saying this is how god-awful it is. She is saying that precisely women are encouraged to be mediocre. And I agree with that, that is why the woman's revolution has had a great deal to offer. What's had to offer is that women have been encouraged to be mediocre and cowardly and simple and to hide their light. And that's terrible. That's terrible for women. It's terrible for men, too. Because anyone who's obliged to become less than they want to become is injured by that. And the form that the injury usually takes is spite and hatred and retaliation in subtle, cowardly ways. So it's no good for men either to have that. And I'm totally opposed to that. I think one half of the woman's revolution has been marvelous. And that's been the half that said women have the right to be more brave. But women have as much tyranny in them as men. And if someone doesn't simply stand up for them and say you're going too far, and you're going too far in a place where there's no need to go that far, then they're going to become Stalinoid brutes.
And you think
like any other power group, the natural tendency of any power group is to become Stalinoid and brutalistic, and oppressive, because any group that isn't resisted tends to give its power. This is almost like a law of physics. It's a law of human physics, if you will. Tends to give its power to the mediocre center, where the people who have the fewest ideas end up dominating the greatest number.
Mr. Miller, do you think that's happening now in the 20 seconds we have left for this program?
No, I think it's happening now where?
In this country.
Yes, I think it's happening to a great extent.
And I gather you think...
And I think it goes as high as the presidency, yes, sir.
I think that's the point which will end this program and pick up here the next time around. Thanks, Norman Miller. Good.
At the end of our second program together in February 1986, Norman Mailer said to me, "You let me talk so long." "Not possible," I say today. So let's pick up now at the very beginning of the program.
I'm Richard Heffner, your host on The Open Mind. In my introduction to the first program I've just finished taping with today's guest, I wished him a happy birthday, pointing out that yesterday Aquarian Norman Mailer ended January, presumably getting not only older, but wiser too. And now I want to go right on finding out just how much more so. Not older, but wiser. Mr. Mailer, the program we did on the air last week, just a few minutes ago, there were so many things I wanted to ask you about, having to do with the Penn Conference, having to do with men, women, and children in America. But let me just dance back and forth a little bit. It seemed to me that there was a connection when you were talking about the difficulty of organizing the recent Penn Conference with something you had said before. You explained your willingness to do so by saying, after you turn 60, you have to take up church work.
You get into church work, I think I said. Okay. Or did I say you have to take it up?
All right. You have to take it up, depending upon what quote you read. But nearly 20 years ago, you said about the same thing, about taking up the arduous task of running for mayor of New York. You said, I am paying my debt to society. That's why I'm running. And I wondered...
I said it ironically.
What more can we expect?
Well, I must say, I said it ironically. I don't believe ever that anyone who's had a reasonable education should ever say, I'm paying my debt to society. I mean, where is society to collect it? Where's society's gate? Where's the toll booth? No, I was being ironic when I said, I'm paying my debt to society.
You don't think there is any?
Well, I think there may be a debt to God. There may be a debt to the cosmos. There may be a debt to one's karma.
But why not to society?
Society may exact a debt from us, but I've never been one of those people who feel that we've got to pay our debt to society. Society is finally is that that working gaggle of mediocrities who make the social machine work.
You said gaggle of mediocrities. Before you, the other program, you said something about the middle class and excellent. It was so interesting. I wonder if you'd develop that, your sense of the purpose.
Well, I think, after all, look, it's middle class people generally who run society, up to a point. At least they are the... They work in all the slots. It's just the upper classes finally who control society, and that's been true for thousands of years. But finally, as I say, there's a tendency for the middle class to get into all the positions of the functionaries. The middle class is besieged on all sides. They're besieged from beneath by the vitality of the lower classes, and they're besieged from above by the superior manners of the upper classes, and we're a besieged group. And as I've said before, the only excuse for us is the pursuit of excellence, because that we can do. We generally end up getting fairly good educations, and we can take them further, and we can improve ourselves. And middle-class life is the search for improvement. When it becomes the search for more money or more status, it gets to be a terribly boring life. It's a life that's not even worth satirizing any longer.
It's funny. I remember a young lady 37, 38 years ago who walked away from me saying, "You're dull and middle-class." I couldn't argue with her about being dull. But I did ask her what other class I was supposed to be, if not middle class.
Well, it's a large class in America. It's probably the second largest class. Maybe it is the largest class. But in any event, society is usually filled by the more mediocre representatives of the middle class. Now, there are public servants who are devoted and hardworking and honest and all of that, and I've met very few of them. Most public servants are in it either to aggrandize themselves or to enrich themselves, or because the job is safe, or because there's small demands on them. All these conservative insistences on reducing government, which of course are highly hypocritical, since I'm sure President Reagan has increased the amount of government since he's been in. He certainly has increased the national debt, which is usually a rough reflection of the size of government. But all this insistence on reducing government does have a real core, which is too much government will encourage a flocking of mediocrities to government.
Do you think that was true of the space program? I went back.
No, I don't think it was true of the space program.
What was the difference there?
Well, the space program, mind you, it's not, you know, if I were to spend a vacation in the place I love most on Earth, I don't think I would pick NASA, in south of Houston, NASAville or whatever it was called. I forget what they call the town now. I spent a good part of a year going there off and on when I was writing a book called "Of a Fire on the Moon." As I say, it's not a place I'd rush to. It's cold. It's the NASA buildings look like a cross between a hospital and a minimum security prison, or a modern college. Abominable architecture, cold atmosphere, computersville. Very tough to take. But there is a great emphasis on excellence at NASA. I mean, I would never pretend that there are people there who are time servers. Space itself is so thrilling a concept, the idea that we can voyage into space, that people put up with most abominable living conditions, as they'll live with plastic, they'll spend their days listening to the quiet drone of computers, they'll live in electronic environments, they'll put up with tasteless food, and when you get into the astronauts themselves, they put up with huge danger. All because there is something that costs them in this extraordinary endeavor.
But you say...
I wouldn't say that mediocrity congregates at NASA, no. I think they have any number of very excellent people there.
You talk about this extraordinary effort. You wrote in A Fire on the Moon, and there I'll go into my superlatives because I remember being so thrilled by it when I read it so many years ago. You wrote, it was that he, Aquarius, the author, it was that he hardly knew whether the space program was the noblest expression of the 20th century or the quintessential statement of our fundamental insanity.
Mm-hmm.
Have you come to a conclusion about that yet?
No, I think that question continues, because now we're getting into Star Wars. And it may be the quintessential expression of our insanity. President Reagan, a most charming man, may be the quintessential expression of our insanity. We've come to the point where we have a man who's president who can charm the populace and touch their sentimental hot points. I mean, he knows Americans far better than I ever will. He'll say things, and I'll say, my God, the American people can't possibly listen to that baloney. And by God, they do. They do. They love it. He knows the country far better than I do. He knows how to please people. He knows how to manipulate people. He knows how to say the things that will warm people's hearts.
Why don't you trust him more, then, if he knows, if he has a knowledge that you don't?
Well, because I never trust a manipulator. A manipulator can know more than I do and be much more effective in life, but I don't honor them, I don't respect them, and I don't want them leading my life. I don't want them taking care of the fate of my children, because a manipulator never knows. In a funny way, a manipulator does not know what the end is, or at least if their notion of the end is cynical.
But you talk about cynical.
Let me go on with that, because I'm leaving it at a loose place. To believe, if you believe the end is noble or worthwhile or deep or cosmically endowed, that the end is something quintessentially superb or thrilling or divine, then you don't rush to manipulate other representatives of God's purpose. If you believe that there is a purpose to our existence, and that we are all, if you will, representatives of God, or agents of God, or collaborators with God, or servants of God, but that we each have a relation to God, then you hesitate to manipulate others who are your equals, who are equally close to God, because it's a cheap, vile activity, and it defies and denies God's purpose. If you are cynical, if you really don't believe in God, then you often pay huge lip service to God. You go to church regularly. You advance in the churches, and you move cynically. I'm a Manichaean. I believe that the one we call God is doubtless the devil, because the devil is nearer to us than God.
Are you making the assumption that if you do go to church regularly, by definition, you are this kind of manipulative person?
No. Well, you may often be one of the manipulated, but I do think that many, many people who go to church often have something to hide, yes.
But you've gone to church, a church of your own. You've worshipped certain ideas.
That's not the same as going to church. Church is a building that you go to where the rhetoric is sometimes excellent, but usually is not too good, where people meet in communion, where people study the Bible, where people do a great many things. I've gone to churches now and again as a tourist. I have a great belief in God, but very little belief in churches.
But why contempt, and it sounds like contempt, for the people who do, who feel other than
I don't have contempt for them. I know any number of very decent people who go to church all the time. I respect them as decent people, but I sometimes think that they're going to church may be the least exciting and least admirable part of them. Now, that's not true for all of them. I never found any group of people that I'd ever say, this is true for all of them. You see, if there's anything I hate, to go back to last week, if there's anything I hate in the women's movement, is that they make certain absolute assumptions. And one absolute assumption is if there are more men than women doing something at a given activity, that's ipso facto bad. And it may have nothing to do with good or bad. It may just have to do with local competence.
Mr. Mailer, because when we tape this program, this was the week of Challenger's and space program's real trouble and the death of brave persons. And you wouldn't deny that
absolutely
the president
not. Very
spoke.
Brave.
Yeah. The mind of the American people, would you have considered that manipulative, his addressing himself to our feelings about these brave people?
Not in this particular case, just because everybody was very moved by it. I mean, I'm probably as hard and unsentimental when I read the papers as anyone I know. I found that I was moved by it. There was something terribly moving about that school teacher, Krista McAuliffe, meeting her death, and the fact that her children were watching was enough to bring tears to one's eyes. It was very moving. It was upsetting. I think everybody in America was profoundly upset. Somebody I know, very intelligent, wise man, said to me, I think this is the worst disaster that struck America since the assassination of John F. Kennedy. Maybe he's right. It was a terrible event, and I think, I'm not saying the president's an unfeeling brute. I did say he's a great manipulator. I don't think you had to be a manipulator on this occasion. You could just speak to the occasion.
Let's stick with the occasion, because it brings up the question that you raised so many years ago in A Fire on the Moon. And I'm trying further to probe what must be some bet that you would make today in answer to that question. It was that he hardly knew whether the space program was the noblest expression of the 20th century or the quintessential statement of our fundamental insanity. Some way you must lean in a direction in one answer or the other.
No, I'm one of the few people I know, and maybe I'm patting myself on the back here, but I'm one of the few people I know who like living with large questions that I can't answer, because I find it enriches the mind if you can do it, in that I lean on one side in one season of my life and lean the other way another time. I can give you a very good argument on either side of that particular question.
But Mr. Mailer, you're not only a disciple of the ambiguous, you're a citizen, and you're going to support actions that answer this question one way or the other, and that's all that I'm
really
trying
to figure out. Well, I think we're cutting a great many corners when you say I'm a citizen, I'm going to support. I have no chance to vote on where, you know, I'm taxed, but I have no real chance to vote on where those monies go. I mean, do I have a chance to vote on Star Wars? Please tell me how I can vote yay for Star Wars or no for Star Wars. The fact of the matter is the average citizen in this country can't vote on how his taxes are used. You can say you can vote for one congressman or another, but that's a long remove from voting about what's done with one's taxes.
But it's no longer removed than it ever has been.
Well, it's more removed because the sums are larger and our power in relation to it is smaller. If we don't have power in relation to $10 million, that's one thing. But we don't have power in relation to $100 billion. That's deeper impotence. If you don't understand what I'm talking about, I can try to put it another way.
No, I do understand, but I wonder then, the age not of Aquarius, but of impotence. Because there are more of us, and the sums get larger, and the long division leaves us as smaller and smaller fractions. But what does that lead you to conclude?
Well, what leads me to conclude immediately, if we're going to shift the ground a little, is that if we don't come to some sort of terms with our economic follies, we're going, and I really must subscribe to the ideas of my old erstwhile friend and then rival, Gore Vidal, who says that if we're not careful, if America and Russia don't find some way to live together, Japan and China are going to take over the world in the 21st century. And I rather think he's right, because their economics, certainly the Japanese economy, is not overloaded with the kind of ridiculous expenditures we make.
What kinds
on armaments and space. You know, what it costs us is staggering to contemplate.
But now, wait a minute. Is that space expenditure, and I'm not talking about Star Wars, that's a comparatively new idea. Presumably you would have said this a couple of years ago. Do you think that the expenditures made on space are made poorly?
No, I'm not competent to judge that. That is, whether they run a tight ship or a sloppy ship, I wouldn't begin to know. I do think we spend prodigious amounts on space, and we don't quite know what we're up to and what we're doing. And I wouldn't mind that, mind you. I wouldn't mind that at all if we didn't have these extraordinary inequities in the society. That does bother me a great deal, because on the one hand, we're engaged in a tremendously exciting but dubious venture, which I think countries should do, by the way. I don't pretend to think the way most people do on this. First, I am for having people go up into space, not just having unmanned satellites, because I think that there's something awesome and disagreeable and even spooky about just sending machines out to do the work for us. It's a particular form of spiritual exploitation of ourselves. In other words, it reduces us further in relation to the machine. It's important that we have people out there as well as machines. And I do think it is one of the most exciting activities of the 20th century. Going out into space is wonderful and splendid.
And not insane.
Something can be wonderful and splendid and still be insane. Insanity is at the edge of all wonderful and splendid ventures. If they fail, then the person who led them was usually insane. There's that wonderful story about Fidel Castro that he landed in Cuba with something like 86 men, lost all but 12 of them the night he landed because he'd been betrayed. He wandered around in the hills for 5 days, turned to one of his people one dawn and said, "The days of the dictatorship are numbered. We will triumph." At that point, the man who relates the story says, "I thought our leader was mad." Well, if Castro had been hit by a sniper's bullet the next moment, everyone would have said, "Of course he was mad." The fact of the matter is, he then went on, he was right. He saw something. He saw something going on in Cuba, whatever it was. Maybe some peasant took them in, a sort of peasant that wouldn't have taken them in a year or two before. He saw something that gave him the idea that the days of the dictatorship were numbered. He was a genius. So he won. He triumphed. If he had failed, then he would have been a fool. He would have been insane. There are a great many people who live in this embattled relation to existence. They're taking such enormous chances that they either, if they succeed, they're one thing. If they fail, they're another. That's what it means to be on the existential edge. It means that you can't write your own obituary.
But you would opt for staying on that existential edge with human beings in the space program.
Yes, I would opt for it there because I think that the tendency of the 20th century is to destroy all the existential edge in life. And that to the degree we keep it alive, we're preserving something we can't quite name.
There was a kind of a thrill, I thought, when you described the way in which human beings were becoming interchangeable parts as you described.
No, there was a certain horror. Why would I be pleased that people are becoming interchangeable parts? What's exciting about that?
Well,
mediocrities are interchangeable parts.
But that was basic to the success of the space program. If those dollars were to be spent successfully, there had to be. I believe you.
I'd say I was impressed by the way in which you had these test pilots, who were highly special individuals, with a great sense of gaming and danger and risk. You know, they loved to drive their cars. Used to drive Corvettes at 100 miles an hour, one foot behind the other, that kind of thing. Play games with one another, tap the brakes, see if the guy behind hits them or not. That sort of thing. Really, play games are absolutely on the edge of things. Yet they submitted to a discipline that was onerous in the extreme, which is they had to be able to take over for one another and become, in that sense, virtually interchangeable parts. That I found interesting as an example of discipline and dedication.
No way the program could have succeeded without that.
No way. Probably no way. I'm just not competent to say whether it could have succeeded without that or not. I think there were decisions made at a certain point to make them interchangeable parts. It might have been more interesting, perhaps, to have had the machines cater to them a little more, but leave that alone. I just am not competent to argue that. I do think something went on with this last shot that was very interesting that no one's quite talked about. And that is, the people who work at NASA are terribly sensitive people in a funny way. They are churchgoers, a good many of them. And they are WASPs. I mean, part of the unspoken scandal of NASA is that you won't find any governmental organization or military organization anywhere in America that is so predominantly WASP to this day. And this organization sees itself as having a religious purpose, which is America is the religion of people who work at NASA. And they are serving the Church of America. And success is terribly important to them, and failure injures them the same way monks or nuns would be absolutely devastated if they sinned, you see. And they tend to take the blame upon themselves in fascinating ways. The people who work for NASA are not people who are trying to pass the buck. When they fail, it comes down upon them like a tidal wave. They hate it. They feel that they've let America down. They've let God down. They're very devoted, dedicated people. They tend to be insular. And if you're an outsider, you don't get to know too much about them, but this is true of them. And one has to honor and respect them for their dedication and their emphasis upon serious work. There are very few people left in America who are willing to work as hard as the people do at NASA. There was always, in the old days, they were always very backward on publicity. I remember some of the old German rocketeers saying to us, you must help us give a push to the machine, because there they were going to the moon, and they had the dullest publicity in the history of publicity. It was incredible. A man was put on the moon, and everybody was bored stiff 2 days later. 2 weeks later, you couldn't get a story about NASA into the papers for a while. Everybody was so bored with it. Well, that was their incapacity for publicity was incredible. Since then, they've taken strides. They took an enormous gamble with Challenger. Absolutely enormous gamble. They were putting a school teacher into space, going in orbit around the Earth. They were going to have the children of America watch it. What they were doing, in effect, is they were seizing the minds of the young. They were attracting the young to space. And they were doing it with a certain sense of risk, because while they certainly weren't prepared for an accident and were terribly shocked when it happened, still, we all know that there's enough about these machines that's delicate so that you can never be certain what's going to happen. Now, they lost on this. They were set back terribly. They were set back a year and a half, 2 years, whatever. There were children who saw it who'd be shocked permanently away from space. I know this ecologist well enough to know that they have to wonder if this was God speaking to them, saying, your activity is insane. Your activity is not desired by the heavens. Because these are religious people. And I promise you that the one thing we can know about what went on with NASA and this dreadful accident, this catastrophe, is that they are the ones who are suffering most because of it, because they are questioning themselves profoundly.
Why did we as a nation fail to grapple with the real dangers? And I think we did.
Real dangers of what? Of this?
The space.
No, it isn't true. They grappled and grappled and grappled.
I'm not talking about NASA. Those of us who watched, so many people said they watched the first few seconds and then, of course, everything was going to go as everything had gone in the past. What an incredible statement about how naive we were about the real and continuing dangers.
Well, but NASA, I think, has wanted to present, been a great deal of writing on this program. They wanted to present it as relatively routine because they wanted to proceed with it.
Public relations.
Congress doesn't vote huge, doesn't give huge appropriations to fireworks. So, not unless they're put into metal cases and stored in the ground and so forth.
Tell me, what's the coincidence of it's being such a waspish organization?
What's the reason?
I
think there are a great many wasps who believe they're the only ones who really take care of America and care about it. And it, I think the form it takes is they all collect at NASA.
It's a military.
It's a combination of it's military, it's church, it's the Weltanschauung of the engineers and the technologues, and they're very, very serious about what they're doing. They're trying to, they live there at NASA. They live to beat the Russians. But, if they didn't have the Russians, they'd have to invent them. The best thing that ever happened to NASA is when the Russians went up, orbited the Earth first. That gave NASA a shot that they're still riding on.
You knew them because you studied them for
a year. I didn't know them intimately. I knew them as well as I could get to know them. They were terribly leery about me, as you can imagine.
As a journalist?
It wasn't that they saw me as a scribbler. Their attitude was, what's his input?
What was his input?
Well, it was a book that some of them read and some didn't.
And you think it was one that... my estimation, and I'm really asking you to confirm or deny, seemed to me to be enormously helpful when published in Life magazine, that it provided tremendous impetus to our further involvement, to Americans' further involvement in that program.
Well, I think it came a little late in the day for the program, because Life had been covering the program in the way Life did, with marvelous photographs and good, interesting topical stories about the program and positive, upbeat stuff. And then this came along, these were thoughtful pieces after the fact, long after Apollo 11 had gone to the moon. And I also was just a small part of the book, but I think by then people were tired of reading about it. I think Life published it because they told me they were going to publish it and they were men of their word.
That's such a strongly modest thing to say, but look, we have...
Let me keep myself off balance.
All right. You mean that's an unusual posture. We have just a couple of minutes left on all these damn questions that I wanted to ask you. We talked about women, Betty Friedan, and the objection of the feminist at the Penn meeting that there weren't enough women. Nadine Gordimer had said, "My observation is that writers are not taken seriously in America. They're regarded as entertainers, while in Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union, they're taken so seriously that sometimes they can't be published at all." An astute, correct observation?
Yeah, I subscribe to that. I agree with that remark.
You don't think in this country they're considered more than entertainers?
No, unhappily. I'm not happy to make that remark, but I think that the only serious writers who are known at all in America are not necessarily the best serious writers, but they're the ones who are the most capable of offering public entertainment of one variety or another. It used to be true with Capote. It's now Vidal, to a lesser extent, myself. There aren't too many writers of that sort. William Buckley, I think, at first, is a man who's interested in politics rather than writing, but he would doubtless be, he would qualify for this category.
Therefore, I have
to certain extent, people like John Irving, Tom Wolfe fit in. But there are a lot of great many terribly serious writers who just aren't known by America's that well because they don't appear on television. They're not entertainers.
Then what happens to a nation in which that is true?
Well, I think a little duller. I think our architecture has been getting worse over the large part. Our cities tend to look more and more alike. It used to be, when I was a kid, I remember it was exciting to get on a railroad train and go from one city to another. You were entering a world that was virtually like going into another country. Chicago was different from New York. Still is, to a degree. I picked the wrong example. But if you go, it used to be that if you went to Denver, you were going to the West. Now, if you go to Denver, you don't know whether you're in Denver, if you're in Oklahoma City, or whether you're in Cleveland, or Dallas. All the cities look the same now. The highways look the same.
I'm always interested in your vision. Does this mean you see things sort of running down?
I think entropy is the curse of the 20th century. The more we invent, the more the forms break down and get monotonous. Plastic proliferates everywhere. People are tired of me saying it, but my God, much as I say it, the plastic proliferates much faster than I could ever say it. Plastic is everywhere, and plastic is deadening. Plastic is made in a vat. Plastic is the waste product of urine and the waste product of oil. You can guess the words. It's on the tip of my tongue.
We've got, I won't guess at it. we're almost through. We have 20 seconds, and what's the sense of trying to get Norman Mailer off on a large question about which he writes tens and tens of thousands of words? I just want to thank you for joining me today. There are so many others. Maybe I can get you to come back and we'll touch on...
Well, I got to admit, it was more fun than it usually is.
Good. Thanks, Mr. Mailer.
Thank you for letting me talk so long.
Thanks to you and the audience. I hope you'll join us again next time. And if you care to share your thoughts about today's program, please do write The Open Mind in care of this station. Meanwhile, as an old friend used to say, good night and good luck.
Continuing production of The Open Mind has been made possible by grants from the Rosalind P. Walter Foundation, the Bluestein Family Foundation, the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, Carnegie Corporation of New York, the Russell Sage Foundation, the Malkin Fund, May and Samuel Rudin Family Foundation, and from the corporate community, Mutual of America.